have no idea how to explain everything, but what I do at my daily job is work with escalations. Sometimes I joke that I sell people, which sounds very bad, but in real life it feels like that sometimes. Work with architectures, work with continuous delivery, company transformations, whatever client needs. Hard to define something specific. And why this talk and why today? Well, it's not like I'm bored of this, but I wanted to do something different, at least for some conference, something different. So, if I would be talking with a client, then I guess these would be things I would be talking about. Again, what is DevOps for some 100th time? I would be talking about technology. Everyone loves containers and so on and so on and so on. But when I'm trying to get to the bottom of a problem, to talk about a little bit about philosophy and things and collaboration, then people, for whatever reason, they hang up on one of those topics which they feel is it's close, and they shut down, and three guys on the back start discussing Docker. So I was trying to avoid that with this talk. So let's see, did I manage? So what I will talk about is bunnies. Who loves bunnies? Good. Who loves cats? Yeah. Do you know there is a research that dogs actually are more popular than cats? It's proven, but typically no one believes that. But it's proven. I hope bunnies will be even more popular after this talk. I don't know. Yeah. Moving ahead. So, the name of talk was DevOps at scale, right? And the whole talk is built from my personal experience as well. No one knew what is DevOps 5 years ago in Latvia. People were reading some blogs here and there. And then when project starts to grow, what people do, well, they start scaling, whatever that means for them. And then for whatever reason, perception is that DevOps at scale, if we have an analogy, bunny or whatever, that you just make it bigger. And that is one way how definitely I got burnt some 2-3 years ago when project went totally to hell. Because we were just scaling our team, we were talking about Scrum and things, it doesn't work that way, at least in my opinion. So instead of talking about Scrum and talking about these things, forget about that. Who has read this book? Good, good. We have two people. Great. At least in DevOps world, this definitely is the most popular book at the moment, DevOps Handbook. It's not made by bunnies. Bunnies are just reading it. These four guys, definitely on the bottom, you can't read it from the back, are DevOps gurus, whatever that means to you. But when you go through the book, it talks about so many great, great things, but it's missing that scaling issue, at least in my opinion. It tries to touch it, but it doesn't really say what to do. It talks a lot about great lean practices, agile practices, security, QA, and so on and so on and so on, but something is missing. That's why let's get to the point, to the bunny land. So, welcome. Story starts like this. This is John. John is a very smart guy, and he got very good idea. In the world where only yellow bunnies exist and no one loves them, he got idea how to make a white bunny. He believes that's the thing. This will work. He found out his approach, how he can do that. After some 3-4 months in his basement, by applying some magic, as people typically do, he made it. He got it done. It took him just a few days to meet this nice little girl named Maze. As little nice girls too. She had very rich father, and she happily bought the bunny and became the most happiest girl in the world. Obviously, what she said, because she also was a smart girl and her father was a businessman, she said, well, I want more. And this is where business starts, right? 20 more. ASAP, as typically it is. So what John did, he found four guys. The name of typical engineer always is Neo, right? And they started to work on this as they could. After 1 month, stuff was done. 20 more bunnies made, sold to Maze. Everyone happy. Maze says, no, now I want 100 more. Well, no one is asking why. Why should you? There's a client, she's buying. So they kept working on this thing. It took, as usual, a bit longer than expected. After 4 or 5 months, 100 bunnies were done. They invited Maze again. She came. But small issue happened. Half of those bunnies run off. Well, that's what bunnies do, right? So John had a problem. How to contain bunnies if he wants to sell everything what his team was making? And then he met a guy named Volya. Meet Volya. Volya is typical, well, let's be honest, ops guy. He knows how to contain things. And he started talking about crate and great idea that he can take those bunnies, put them in the crate, and this way deliver them without running away to Maze. Perfect idea. Let's start working together. So that's what they did. Guys working, growing bunnies, using magic, and these guys building crate. Three Volyas. They always have same name. I don't know why. Good. This is working. This is fine. Finally, after some 3 months, everything was done. But there was one very, very small issue that before Maze came, they finally decided, let's put those bunnies in a crate, right? But they didn't fit in. Happens. Well, they were building crate. In the meantime, those guys were growing bunnies. Happens. Solution was quite simple. Let's split them in halves and put in the crate. Obviously, Maze wasn't happy about that. Yeah. But, well, she wasn't giving up. She said, okay, I will take that 100 if you will deliver it after 2 months. And they will not run away. They will be one whole of a bunny. And then she's buying. Imagine how much money John already has lost. It's his only client. He can't really say no. Otherwise, business is gone. So yeah, obviously he agreed, and he was thinking, well, what to do now? How to fix this? And he found guy Scott. Scott was saying, well, I know a lot of things. I know how to work, how to negotiate, how to work with contracts. I'm coming with IT background. I know configuration management. I know release management. Sounded as a really smart guy. And what he said, you need a system in between which will transfer those bunnies into the crate before they grow up. So they will be small and they will fit in and issue solved. Sounded as a great idea, isn't it? Obviously, everything was delivered some 2 weeks late, as typically it happens with projects. And they invited Maze over. She came. She found crate full with 100 bunnies. Success. Opens it and, well, there's a small issue. They start biting her. Well, Scott jumped in and immediately said, well, no one said that bunnies need to be nice. Right? It's not in the contract. Okay. Maze took few of them. Probably they will sell. No one knows what happened after. Did she have a bigger animal or not? That's off a book. But what they agreed on that, okay, she will still take those 100 bunnies after 5 months, but make them better, that they don't bite, that they are nice ones, as that very, very first one, which she still loves. I hope it's still alive. They don't live for very long. But John needed to fix this somehow. So he remembered about his childhood love, Angie. Angie loved bunnies, the yellow ones, red ones, white ones as well. And she had a system that she can actually assert which ones are good, which ones are bad. Should work perfectly. What they did, obviously, is put Maze in the middle of their system or process, whatever you call it. So once bunnies are ready, she comes in, tests them, asserts them, and good ones go to the crate. Perfect. Done. So, after, well, 3 months overdue of the project, Maze finally is invited, she comes, they open the crate, Maze looks at bunnies, and, well, there is a small issue, tiny issue. Half of them are dead. Well, you can imagine what Scott said. In contract, it's not written that they need to be alive. So yeah, you can't disagree with that. They started negotiating what to do with these bunnies, what to do with next ones, because Maze still wants more bunnies. No one is asking why, but it's a business. So they agreed, okay, let's do this. Next time when she comes, 60% of bunnies must be alive. It's a bit better than this deal. So, yep, makes sense. Deadline, 6 months, let's do this. When Maze was walking out, she picked up her phone, phoned someone, and she was saying something like, if I would know who can make such bunnies, then I would just go to them and leave these guys. But who cares? They are the only ones who can make white bunnies. No one can compete with them. So they needed to continue work. Business is coming, money is coming. But still, that issue with short lives of bunnies need to be solved somehow. So John remembered about another childhood friend, Florence, who claimed that she's an architect, she is another IT expert, that she has been doing engineering of different animals for many, many years. And the problem what bunnies are having and what project is having is they need to do stuff in phases because there's a lot of chaos. They are doing everything at once. That's not a good idea. So what she proposed was the way how you make a bunny needs to be done by separate teams and phase by phase. So you start with small amoebas, basically, then you grow them into eggs, then you start making a form, then you test it with Angie, finally it gets into big release machine and put it in crate. Perfect. Florence was so excited by these new white bunnies that she started to draw new designs of those bunnies. Well, obviously it didn't work from first time, so it was improving. They started living longer because of new approach. But the problem is that Florence started drawing those designs like every day a new design and how can you cope with that? So they made 5 and more lines and hired more people, hired more managers to deal with different designs what Florence has made, to test them, to see what's the outcome. Obviously, to make one bunny, now it takes 3-4 months to make one bunny just to see, does it work? Crates were done a long time ago. So, well, Voljas got busy. There was no work for them. They just keep working on these bunnies and that's it. John saw that. He found that out. He fired them. There is a great solution. Once they will need to deliver them, they will call offshore and get those guys in for very cheap money and deliver whole thing. Sounds like a good idea. So, Voljas, gone. John, seeing that this all works perfectly, actually there was small research that this new approach, how they now grow these bunnies, is increasing their engineering performance, their growing performance, about 30%. The more work is done by some 30%, the efficient work. Great. So he left for his vacation, somewhere to Bahamas, or I don't remember really. And after 2 weeks, he came back. Well, it was a bloodbath. There was nothing to find. Crazy stuff. And one design with 8 legs bunny. So no one could explain what happened, what is going on. Few people remained sitting there in shock. Couldn't be able to explain anything. It's hard work growing bunnies. Okay, so John understood, well, this is not working. We are already over deadline. We have no bunnies, nothing. And then he called his freakish childhood friend who always has been a geek, but like genius one, as they do. And he started telling his problem that this is what happened and so on. And that's Martin. Martin quickly jumped on an issue, talked about DevOps culture and lean and agile and Scrum and Kanban and a lot of things, continuous delivery, and that automation is a key. That's what John heard. Automation is a key. So he hired for very big money Martin immediately. He has an answer, let's do this. So he pushed Martin, let's do your automation. Yes, done. Well, Martin did his best. Got other guys like him helping him, and they made small automation between those phases as John ordered. To make process faster, to separate those teams from each other so they stop fighting. And it was working pretty well. Great. So, the happy story, happy ending. Bunnies done, living for a very long time. Designs were already done by Florence before, so they just went with the best one. They called Maze, said, well, we have your bunnies, please come. She's saying, well, I will not come. I don't want to come. If you can deliver them to my doorstep, I will pay half price for your bunnies. Well, everyone was in shock. No one needs that many bunnies. There's no Volja to deal with that crate. So obviously they went to Martin and, well, Martin, what we can do? We need to deliver these heavy crates to Maze's doorstep. Martin had a solution like this. Let's use cloud. And it worked. In few seconds, they were able to deliver it to Maze. Price paid. Project covered. If no one takes vacation for next 10 years, fine. Project delivered. So Maze said, okay, well, I will take 10 times more, so about 1,000. If you want to, I have a lot of money. If you can deliver that in half year. Well, John couldn't say no. 10 times bigger deal, he must take it. He said yes, he left. As it happens. Okay. So, they kept working. Martin tried to also, well, put everything in crate, in cloud. Process was going. Project was a bit late. Everything was done after a few years. Everyone was so happy about great performance, system being in order, people working in their teams. Perfect. Perfect project. So after 3-4 years, finally, yeah, they had 1,000 bunnies, long living ones. Perfect. They tried to deliver them to Maze. For whatever reason, half of crates didn't deliver. They just disappeared. Martin couldn't explain this because he said, well, I'm not Volya. So, well, half. Good enough, half, right? So they waited for Maze, said, hey, we are here. We have half of stuff you need. Come out. But she didn't. She said, well, sorry, you are a few years late. And I don't want your product anymore. Okay. John just fainted. While he was sleeping on the ground or in the bed, as in picture, he got a dream. A nightmare, I'd say. He saw that 10 legs bunny, which was the last thing that Florence designed when she disappeared. He woke up and got idea. Why are we spending so much effort making so many small bunnies? Let's make one, the big one, and invite everyone over. So we don't need to deliver them. We don't need to risk with that. Project was over anyway. So he tried to get people together, agreed with them that, well, you guys have no jobs anywhere anyway. Your skills are out of date, so let's work on this new thing. And everyone, not everyone, but some people agreed. So that's what they started to do. They even got Florence back because, well, that's her design. She really got excited. Scott was working on Golden Crate. Martin didn't really catch the idea and was off for some time. And they were designing one big, big bunny. After 6 months or something, project was done. They invited Maze. They said, Maze, call your friends. We have something what you haven't ever seen. No simple white bunnies. We have this new thing. You will be amazed, and your word is maze, so you must come. She came. Perfect. One big bunny. Well, most of girls liked it, Maze and her friends. Few of them, not that much. They were saying that, well, I don't like this leg. I don't like that leg. So they collected all that information, put that on a backlog, and said, okay, we will make a new bunny as you like it in 3 months. And then the next one, taking other things they have agreed on. So everyone will be happy at end. They started work. They started to make a new bunny with one different leg, because that's what girls asked for. Well, swapping the bunny took about a week, and girls were quite frustrated and asking back for money. One was so attached to old leg that she said, I will not pay anything again ever. I want back my bunny. And most of them, for whatever reason, again, wasn't happy and were asking for new legs, new head, new body. Well, that's again what they wrote down, agreed, okay. We will deliver what you need, and we will avoid that 1 week swap period when there is no bunny. So they got, obviously, Martin. And they pushed Scott to change this name to Martin, because Martin was genius. Scott, well, you saw what happened. Many Scots changed their names to Martin, which was kind of interesting. Happens. And they started working on this new project, new idea, how to swap it faster, how, what to do with lags, and so on. So in a few days, now they were capable to swap the bunny. They did that. Obviously, someone again was frustrated that old bunny is, well, in the bushes somewhere, not for others to see. One girl liked the new leg, which is great. But Maze didn't show up. Those all are her friends. She didn't come. Odd. And it wasn't that many girls as before. So something is going wrong. This is not good. So John, after all these years of working on this project, understood, probably I need to go and talk with Maze one-to-one. What's going on? Why she didn't come? This is they are the only ones who have such type of bunny. So he met her. She was willing to meet him because she started telling him about Amazon-y, about Netflix-y, Spotify-y. Everyone was making white bunnies now. And they're way faster than John was. Okay, that's a problem. John understood, well, we are out of business. Everyone now is going to them. We need to change something drastically now. So he went to Oracle Google Gunny and picked up few words what Maze was talking about. He looked at these companies, what they are publishing about themselves, and understood, yeah, now I know what to do. Well, DevOps. And he did. Fired few people who are not really important, put everything together in one pool because it's everything shifting left and so on. So many blogs he read. And they delivered. In few weeks, they made new bunny with new leg, swept it. Everything was great. Everyone was super happy. Perfect. Again, they called Maze, of course. She came over. They opened the big, how you call it, curtain. And well, that bunny was a bit angry. Luckily, Volia showed up like an angel from nowhere and killed the big beast. That who could have gone very, very wrong. Things happen. Everyone left. Everyone said, we are not coming back ever again. And there was something about suing them and so on, as it typically happens. Okay. That's it. Project killed. So John called everyone after a few weeks, called Maze as well to make a big apology. Everyone came because they had no job anyway. They all had on the record this great project. And before he started to open his talk, Martin showed up and said, will you listen to me now? Because everything what we did isn't what I meant. Everyone had nothing to say anyway. Half of them wasn't listening. Well, no job, nothing, who cares? And he talked for some 3-4 hours. No one got anything from that. But he was the only guy who had at least some idea, something. And somehow they agreed, okay, let's try to do what Martin is saying. Let's just go with it. Nothing is working anyway. We are bad at our jobs. So what Martin suggested is, okay, let's not kill the bunny. let's just detach one leg. And instead of using pools, let's use trenches. And how one small team working on that trench. That was a start. So they started kind of splitting the unhappy bunny piece by piece, but it was still alive and it was staying where it is, which is better than being killed, right? They went forward. They detached other legs as well and got Maze's girlfriends as well, put them all in small teams of all these guys who know how to build a leg, how to engineer it, and started making legs one by one. Over time, they went crazy. They decided that, well, actually, girls typically like touching legs, but not that much feeding the bunny. So they detached head as well. And body as well. So few trenches were able to make more bunnies, more legs, like one per day, while new body was needed once per month or once per week. Really, what do girls want? What do they need? Everyone was happy, believe me or not. Well, bunny alive, kind of keyboard, but still alive, doing what it is supposed to. They went one step further. You see these trenches. So everyone was digging his own trench, which is quite an effort, and no one knows how to do that. So they decided, let's have one team who will be making these trenches and changing trenches for others, or at least suggesting that, and improve this trench every day, the same as they do with legs or bodies or heads, whatever. Once per month, later on once per week, they started getting all together. They called them meetups, brown bags, and so on and so on. So many names, it didn't really matter what's the name. But they were talking about stuff, what they do. They were sharing their ideas. They started doing hackathons, as that was fancy name back then. On one of them, one of teams, which was just trying to figure out something new because there's nothing new to do, they are changing legs every day to something better, but it doesn't really change, came up with a new idea. Let's put sensors in the leg. So now they can identify perfectly which places of bunny's leg are being touched more. This way, they already knew what's wrong with each leg once they have attached it to bunny and girls have started using it, if you like that word. Yeah, so that's also what they did. Put sensors in all parts of the bunny, so now they knew exactly what's working, what's not, like immediately. Well, I guess you can assume that now I'm getting to happy end, to real happy end. After some time, they started to experiment with other animals. I hope there are no animal protectors in the room. No one got killed for this presentation, okay? Yeah, of course, companies like Spotify and Google Annie bankrupted. They were the main ones in the happy, happy bunny land. So, getting back to basics. Is DevOps at scale, taking bunny, making it bigger, making team bigger, does it really work? In my opinion, not. In real life, I have done what I was talking about. And that system almost ate someone. What it means. Huge downtime for 2 days, no one knows what's going on, why? That's what happens in real life. We have a little bit of time. I was thinking, okay, let's kind of talk about DevOps as well, or what I mean with this. Everyone has a project of some kind, and on good projects at least, there are those, now it's called DevOps tools, so source control system, some release management system, some automation, something. And typically in projects, we have that. Tools and the product what we are building. That's a good start, of course. But when we talk about scaling, well, over time in your company or in your project, it really depends on the size, you get another system or project or client where you are probably building something similar, but it's a little bit different. And then we always need to make that choice. Are we running the new project on same tools, or we will spin up all tools from the beginning, double effort, but not being coupled to a previous project. So that's a choice to make. What we did, we decided, okay, let's take another platform and start controlling with that one, those projects and platforms in those projects. So that's actually three DevOps platforms working together. Imagine Git. Now, there's Git. It gives control. It gives ways how to industrialize, how to reuse code which is being made there, but it still has issues. Imagine if you have a project of five different clients selling similar thing, but still it's different because of many reasons. Like, it's enough to have one client on AWS, one on Azure, on different cloud providers. Already so many things are different. So this works, but it's not perfect. So why we did this? To get those trenches sharing real source code between them. So what clients can start doing is stuff they make here, small modification to something, so to some provisioning script or to the system, they can start moving it back sourcing to central platform, and others automatically can get those new bug fixes or whatever, which is very, very complex project. It's a lot of automation, but this is what we call DevOps at scale. Because still everyone can be free in things they do. They can reuse stuff. Well, that's basically open source concept, that's it. But still company is having control on things that are happening. But yeah, it's hard. And this is what we call DevOps at scale. Yes. That's it. That's the happy ending.
Thank you, Uldis. So let's go for the questions and answers. And don't forget, you can get a very nice planning poker cards for your answers. Questions, sorry.
Yep. Hello, thank you for this horror story. Mm-hmm. And the question is, maybe the problem is the uncontrolled scaling. So we need to control it, or maybe someone to stop the scaling and to not to have any additional money that we didn't get in your story. So this is the first question, and maybe what is your answer?
It will sound that I'm answering absolutely something else, sorry for that. We in DevOps talk quite a lot about Red Queen race, which means you never stay in the same position, you grow bigger, you go faster, you make more money, because staying in the same position, in the same revenue, means that soon someone will be faster than you. Simple as that. About control, This is exactly about that. How to have project which can run as fast as they want to, but still have some control. Because typically in projects, we have full control. Big project on hierarchy going up, and one on the top making decisions, which is slow. And there needs to be some balance. How to be under control, how to be, well, what's the good word? I wrote it down. Flexible. flexible in things they do, to be autonomous.
Okay. But to this slide, don't turn it away. So this is the standard knowledge technology sharing schema, or I don't know. But do you think that in our days this is the next problem that the big companies and the big developers are facing, because the small teams, they are not developing, they are searching in the sharing technologies some nuances, some small features, and implement these features, and the product is getting some monstrosis of something not the ideal coded.
What does it mean, ideal coded for someone?
Yeah.
What's ideal for other, for someone else? It's not. That's the whole concept of teams, what team believes in. We are fostering a lot this being autonomous, making your own decisions, having a team which will build and maintain and support by themselves and take full responsibility. If there is big hierarchy, that's just not possible. Because then you make L1 support who, well, they do what they can, and typically customers are not that happy about that. Here, with, well, this is all about microservices as well, and how to live in that world. So this supports the concept. And scaling means, well, vertical scaling, it's very hard, it's slower with every day. So now, in DevOps specifically, we talk about flat structures. And this way, we can start adding small teams more and more and more without slowing down. Well, a little bit, maybe, because control still is needed. Well, not what Netflix would be saying, that they give full autonomy to their teams. I don't believe that, honestly, but that's what they are saying sometimes, that they have a team and they do what they can, what they want, as long as it's making money. On the platform, which is on the bottom, controlled, centralized.
My question is about customer intimacy. What do you do to make sure you're building the right bunny?
Talk with Maze. In perfect scenario, get her over, get her in the project.
Okay, so how do you apply that in DevOps?
Depends on client, really. And if client is really DevOpsy, or let's just say agile, then they will send their user, customer, whoever is the end piece of the system who will use that, and work with engineers, with everyone, if not every day, then when it's needed, really, when some new stuff is being discussed, when some new stuff is being finished, do reviews of finished project once it's finished, instead of once per month or once per week. Once per week is great, but even that can be improved. So have them as part of the whole engineering process.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for your story. It was nice. Am I right that you said that your preferred option is to have a separate team that designs the trenches? So the flow, this system that I see is maintained by one team, one specialist team that builds all these scripts and stuff to get things going. Is that what you said?
Okay. For analogy, this is the team who is building trenches and which has trenches for other products.
Okay.
So there's a lot of trenches. If you're into continuous delivery a little bit, we now talk about continuous delivery pipelines. Every pipeline is a trench. That's the analogy. So there's a lot of them. So few teams here, few teams here, few teams here, but typically one who is working on trench here, on trench here, and so on.
But that means that you're centralizing that knowledge into one team, and that means that they're going to sub-optimize for creating the best trenches. That's not what you want, right? You want every team to be optimized. So why don't you, what's against having this technology of building trenches available in each team so that each team can adapt their trench as needed?
I guess I didn't explain it well enough, and it's hard to imagine, but that's the whole point, that you begin here to make a new client. You make it. You just copy all sources, clone branches, clone repositories, and provision new system, new product, vanilla. And then team starts changing that. They make good changes, they make bad changes. Some of that definitely will be useful for others. So they can just share it back. And there needs to be some central point who says, this is good stuff, this is bad stuff. Good stuff, they can promote for others and say, guys, there are fixes for everything, just use it. Do you want that? If they disagree, then they disagree.
Well, I don't think that needs to be a central guy saying this is good, this is bad. If the stuff is not being reused because it's not useful, then it will die. And if it's very good, then people are enthusiastic and will share it, and other people will implement it. So it's a living system, right?
It is a living system. There comes the word enterprise, where here is client, like big client, and here is client who probably is competing to this client, and then saying, guys, there's new feature, just use it. It all needs to be approved by client, and so on and so on.
Okay, thanks.
That's the enterprise world. Of course, it's not easy.
Hello. I have a question about the change control. If you share the code between the clients, how to avoid situations when the fix for a bug for one client happens to be a bug for the other? When for one is the feature, for other it's a bug. So how to avoid these situations? Is there any advice in this?
In highly automated system, you would catch it with automated tests. If that's a really client says this is a bug, then only by showing that to client. Just like that. There is no other way.
But you embed the change in the testing system. This is the new way, the new test case that we have to fulfill. And that goes to the automation system, and the test passes, but the bug is for other client is just because that feature exists. So
theoretically, it is possible. There are no systems with zero bugs. Yes, these things theoretically may happen. That's why we put in continuous delivery pipelines, all automated testing, stress testing, pen tests, and so on, to try to minimize that, to mitigate that to the possible minimum. But yeah, there are no systems without bugs. Yes, it may happen.
Okay, thank you. Just a reminder, speaker is available for you. You can catch him in the corridors and go for the talk in the details. As I see, there are a lot of the questions. But now we need to check reality about the bunnies. Feedback time.
One last thing, please.
Yep.
Please, one last thing. So, personally, I and a few other people and Dev Club LV, you know Edgar's, many of you, I believe so, we and with Visma as well, we are making first DevOps conference in Riga in September, so please check that out. If you want to know more about it, look for DevOps meetup on 17th of July, which also is kind of the first meetup for DevOps specifically, where these things exactly will be discussed. It will not be technical stuff. So yeah, look for that. Come to conference. Yeah.
Thank you. So feed.